for that very gracious introduction. I'm extremely happy, honored to be here to give this memorial lecture. I sadly never had the opportunity to meet Katikarneni Mahipati Rao. I wish I had met him. I have happily had the opportunity to meet Mahigaru, who's been extraordinarily kind and gracious to me, and today I've also met other members of the family. I'm very honored to be here tonight. I'm also very happy to come to Hyderabad. I'm always happy because actually I'm a Hyderabadi. I lived in this city. I lived in this city for several months in 1997-98, and I come every year. I was completely captivated by Hyderabad, especially by its Telugu, but also by its Hindi and its Persian and the whole enchanted history of the place. I'm always very happy to come back, and on a beautiful winter day like today in particular, it's been a great pleasure. So thank you. The title of this lecture has a question in it. You know, a South Indian view of truth. I mean, it may seem strange to you. In fact, somebody said to me, this is an odd topic, why would one talk about a South Indian view of truth? Isn't truth some natural, universal kind of thing? We all know what truth is. So truth must be the same. We might think it should be the same. Everywhere, there's truth and there's falsehood. But actually, a little reflection might show that this is not actually the case. That in fact, ideas of truth, of what truth means, of what truth might be, of how it works, how we would define it, how it acts, these change from place to place and culture to culture. I'll try to convince you of this. Let me take 2 or 3 minutes at the beginning of the lecture to say something of a comparative nature. So, you know, in Greece, the word for truth is aletheia. Aletheia actually means something like a non-inattention. In other words, a form of paying attention. It comes from the root lantano, lantanomai, which means to fail to pay attention. It's a very important word in Greek, because most of the time we do fail to pay attention. So truth actually would be somehow managing to pay attention to something that is actually there, that we may already know. And if we fail to pay attention, as we usually do, then we're in the domain of falsehood. And because paying attention has certain very specific resonances in Greek, so there's a sense here of a kind of veil that is normally cast over our eyes so that we don't see the truth. And by paying attention, we can remove that veil, at least for a moment. But you see, this is a very Mediterranean way of thinking about truth. It comes out of the specific landscapes of Greece, that sunlight, that sea, those smells. It belongs in that Mediterranean world. If I wanted to talk about Hebrew notions of truth, old Hebrew notions, so I might mention famous rabbi Yehuda Leib of the city of Prague, medieval rabbi. He is said to have created what is called a golem. A golem is a kind of bhutam, some kind of spirit, anthropoid spirit who would do his bidding. And he created this golem by writing on his forehead. He had various Kabbalistic, mystical ways of doing this. But he wrote on his forehead here the 3 Hebrew letters emet, which is truth in Hebrew, emet. But there came a time when this bhutam was becoming too dangerous for its creator, and he wanted to return it to dust. And he did that by removing the first of the 3 letters. So emet is truth. If you take the first letter e away, it becomes met, which means dead. And when he removed that letter, this bhutam became inert and died. So you see, if you look at that story, just at that little story, you can see that in Hebrew, emet is somehow connected to notions of being alive. Truth is somehow connected to degrees of aliveness, of the condition of being alive. That's not something which is self-evident. I want to give you an example from India, from classical India, from Sanskrit, just to show you that there is an interesting topic here, a kind of problem. So many of you will know the play that is called the Mrichakatikam, that is the little clay cart. Some of you will know it from the famous Hindi film about the Santasena. So I was reading this play with my students. Just to remind you briefly, we don't have time, but very briefly, this is a play about somebody called Charudatta, who was a wealthy man who's lost his wealth because of excessive generosity. He has a friend, Maitreya, who is a kind of clown, the Vidushaka. So there's a courtesan named Basantasena who has entrusted Charudatta with her jewel box, a box of gold and jewels, under circumstances that I don't want to explain, for safekeeping. Of course, it happens that Charudatta is in love with Basantasena. That's also not irrelevant. Right? So one night, a very charming thief called Sharvilaka, who is a master of the Shastra of thieves, because, you know, thieves too should have a Shastra to tell them how to make a hole in a wall and break into a house. So this Sharvilaka makes a hole into the house of Charudatta, this kind of crumbling mansion, and he steals that box of Basantasena. So when this is discovered in the morning, Charudatta, of course, is horrified, absolutely horrified. This was given as a trust to him. The friend Maitreya, very characteristically, like a good Vidushaka, he says, well, actually, there's no problem at all. Nobody gave any box. Nobody took away any box. And anyway, nobody saw it happen. You know, that's the Vidushaka speaking. But Charudatta, of course, isn't happy with that. He can't be satisfied with it because he's actually betrayed the trust. So at that critical moment, Charudatta's wife comes and she offers him a very expensive necklace, which is more or less all that's left to the family. She says, you can use this in order to give back the box, you know, the what the box was worth. And Charudatta, at first, he's very reluctant to take this and even says, a man who has to be saved by his wife is not a man but a woman. He's ashamed. But upon reflection, he says the following rather interesting verse. He says, before he says the verse, important thing, he agrees that he's going to use this necklace. He gives it to his friend Maitreya, and he says, you take this, please, to Basantasena and tell her, the box that you gave me, by mistake, I staked it in a game of dice and I lost it. So please accept this necklace in lieu of the original box. You know, that's what he says. And then he says the following verse. He says, Pari bhavanugata bharya, I have a wife. I'm lucky, he says, a lucky man. I have a wife who is somehow commensurate with my own nature. Sukha dukha suhrid bhavan, I have you, Maitreya, as my friend in happiness and in sorrow. Satyam cha napari brashtam. And Satya, my truth, has not been destroyed, has not been ruined. Yet daridreshu durlabam, he says, which is all of this together, something which is a little unusual, he says, among people who are poor, because he's now poor. You know. So, okay, that's the verse. You heard the verse. You know, we were reading this, one of my students suddenly said, what does this mean? Satyam chanapari brashtam. He says, he's just given orders to his good friend Maitreya to tell an outright lie about having lost this, you know, trust while playing dice. And what he has to say about that is that his truth has not been compromised. How could that be? So, of course, it's easy to explain this. We can explain it by saying that he doesn't actually mean truth in the technical sense of the word. He means something like truthfulness, or one might say, to use modern terms, something like his character. His character will somehow be salvaged. Or we might even use a very modern term, which really doesn't fit the context so much, but nonetheless, something like integrity. You could say his integrity is somehow going to be intact. But actually what he says is satyam. He says truth, you know. So I'm not going to say very much more about satya as a concept in Sanskrit, except maybe towards the end of the lecture I might have a remark or two to say. This is a problem in Sanskrit as it is in South India. But I just want you to know that I hope I've persuaded you by now that there's something interesting here. That maybe there is a notion of truth which is worth thinking about. Perhaps there's even a South Indian notion of truth. South India is a big place with many languages and many cultures. And I only have 45 minutes. I'm not going to be able to give you a survey of South Indian notions of truth, but I am going to take one text, the Kamba Ramayanam, the Tamil Ramayana. And the reason I've chosen this is because the Kamba Ramayanam, those of you, I know there are many people in the audience here who know Tamil, so you will know that this is a work which, in like a few great works in world literature, this is a work which somehow embodies the ethos, the metaphysics, the nature, one might say, the inner nature of an entire civilization. I'm not going to say much more about the text now. We don't have time. I'll just say we think it's perhaps a 12th century text, and it was written in the Kaveri Delta, not at the Chola court, but at a time when the Chola kingdom was flourishing. And I have to tell you, it's my favorite book in Tamil. I read the Kamba Ramayanam all the time, partly for the reason that I mentioned, because I believe it beautifully encapsulates this entire civilization. Also, it's a book which you can open at random, and actually every verse will be interesting and unusual. But aside from that, I am particularly interested in the Ayodhya Kandam, because the Ayodhya Kandam has as its theme in the Kamba Ramayanam this question of truth. You could say it's a long essay about truth. By the way, I just mentioned that there's a new translation of the entire Kamba Ramayanam, which is scheduled to come out in the Murti Library of Classical India. Some of you will know about this. It's being launched here in India within the next 2 weeks. And they've parceled out the kandams of the Kamba Ramayanam among a series of translators. These are bilingual editions. It'll be Tamil and English. This will be the first proper translation of the Kamba Ramayanam ever into English, a full translation with annotations. And I had the privilege of doing the Ayodhya Kandam, so you can see I'm close to these materials. Okay. Now, I've chosen three or four passages, short passages. We don't have much time. We're going to look at these passages. The only way we could actually deal with this question of a South Indian notion of truth is inductively, by seeing if there's something here which is a little different, something that we could define. So I'm going to read a few passages with you. I'll also recite two or three Tamil poems. I might say just a word about the Tamil words for truth. In particular, there are three terms that are common in Tamil. There is what is often called unmai. Unmai comes from an important root, ul, ulgu, which means really to think or to have some kind of internal thought or feeling or apprehension. But it's also connected to another root, a homonymous root, ul, which means to be inside, to have some kind of interiority. All speakers of South Indian languages know this root, undu, undi. So to be inside, to have some kind of inner experience of thought or feeling. Unmai, that's one. There's the word me, or meimai in Kamban. This word, by the way, is another homonym, that is to say, it sounds exactly like the word me, meaning body. But may means truth. It's one of the words for truth. And as a concept for truth, we have what is called in Tamil vaimori. That is to say, something which is spoken through the mouth. Truth is true speech. And you notice that we're talking about real speech, something that has to be said aloud. Okay, it's not something that one thinks, but something that one says. Okay, let's have a look at the first passage. So we're in the Ayodhya Kandam, and I'll just briefly refresh your memories. Everybody knows this by heart, I'm sure, but just to be sure, This is right after the moment when Kaikeyi has explained to Dasharatha what she wants, namely that her son Bharata will be crowned king instead of Rama, and that Rama will go into the forest for 14 years. And she is able to request this because many years before, Dasharatha had promised her two boons because she saved his life in a particular battle. Okay? Everybody knows this situation. So when she says it, Dasharatha is completely overcome. By the way, I'm not going to concentrate here on small differences between the Kamban version and the Valmiki Ramayana. I think it's kind of a waste of time to do that. There are some differences. The really important differences have nothing to do with what changes in the plot, but with the whole feeling and tone and texture of this. Okay? So Dasharatha, he's fallen to the ground. He's in shock and in grief. And Vasishta, the guru of the family, is there. He's trying to comfort him. Actually, Vasishta still thinks that he can save the situation. Vasishta, in this passage from Kamban, is kind of a politician. He thinks there's got to be some clever way out of this problem, and he offers various rationalizations. They're not terribly satisfying. So let's read the passage that you have before you. Maybe I'll start with the verse before it when Vasishta speaks. Vasishta saw it and said, "Master, put aside this great sorrow. The prince will rule this land in the pride of manhood. What obstacle can intervene? She who spoke those inglorious words will herself give him the crown. If this one black as a rain cloud, were to refuse it and go away, would we go on living? Suffer no more." That is Vasishta. "We'll find a way out of this situation." That is Vasishta's plan. Now, you have the text in front of you. The king looked at the sage. "Master," he said, "before I die, heavy with unthinkable deeds, make him wear the great crown. Make him stop thinking of the wilderness and save me from the shame that rests in my words." The sage looked straight at the fierce woman who had done the hateful deed. "Now," he said, that is Kaikeyi, "now," he said, "golden lady, won't you give back the kingdom to your son, who is the breath of life to all of us, above all to your husband, who holds fast to Manu's way, and thus win a good and holy name, free from blame." He spoke, who had cut off karma at the root, and she, Kaikeyi, wept, gasping for breath, as she said, "If the king swerves from truth, I will have no desire to live on in this world. To ensure that my word does not turn to a lie, I will die." I'll read the last verse in Tamil, or rather sing it. Moi man vinai virala vindru uyarvan moriya munnam Vimaruva larasan meil tidivan yenin ima bulahatu yero inivarvu havin yen sol poemana markindre pondra dorien yendral. She actually says what she has to say by using a double negative. If the king swerves from truth, I will have no desire to live on this world. And to ensure that my word does not turn to a lie, I will die. Actually, she says, I cannot not die. And all of you who speak South Indian language know that a double negative in Indian languages, unlike in English, a double negative, I cannot not die, it's a very strong positive. In English, it's a rather weak positive. If you say something is not uninteresting, it's not much of a compliment. But in Indian languages, usually it's quite the contrary. A double negative is a strong positive. "No, I will definitely die," she says, "if the king swerves from truth." So you can see she's talking about truth. Well, something a little unusual about this situation, if you think about it, Kaikeyi, I mean, she's crying, gasping for breath. She's weeping, but really she should be satisfied, shouldn't she? I mean, after all, she got what she wanted. Of course, she was put up to it, we know, by Mantara, Kuni in Tamil. We know that. So maybe it wasn't actually her own deepest wish, but she was convinced. And look at her. She's in grief, and she's somewhat bewildered. She doesn't know what to do. She's crying. Actually, it's apparently sudden upon her that she's about to kill her husband. He's going to die. She can see that this is going to happen. And notice how she sees this. It's as if it was what we now call a zero-sum game. That is, either he dies or she'll die. There's no third option. Why is it that there's no third option here? Why is it that Vasishtha cannot find a way out? Well, you see that in the Tamil text, you can see by the way it's articulated, has something to do with language, with words. Dasharatha says, there's shame that lies in my words. And Kaikeyi says, if the king swerves from truth, I will have no desire to live on in this world. To ensure that my word does not turn to a lie, I will die. There's something here about speaking. Dasharatha said something. Long time ago he said it. Very interestingly, this doesn't seem to have anything to do with what Dasharatha actually was intending himself. When he said what he said, he had no notion that it was going to develop like this, right? He said it long ago. There's no intentionality involved at all, except the fact that he offered her these two boons because she'd done him a good deed. You know? That's an interesting thing, isn't it, if you think about it, because he said something, and now he has to hold to it. In order to show you where I'm going, let me try to formulate this in a simple way. It seems, on the basis of a passage like this, and there are many like this, that the spoken word, has a life of its own. It's as if once you say it, vaimori, something that comes out of your mouth, once you say it, then it is a kind of living force, autonomous in a way. It lives its own life in the world. It's been released into the world, and you cannot stop it from doing what it has to do. Incidentally, it's interesting that this notion, which I think is a profound South Indian notion about language and truth, it's interesting that it's different from the language of blessings and curses, especially curses, shapa. Of course, it reminds us of shapa, kind of curse that somebody, a sage, might say if he gets angry. Also blessings. You know, the interesting thing about the shapa is, although you can't recall the word, usually you can somehow modulated or moderated. You can usually add some kind of clause which will somehow make the full force of the curse at least capable of coming to an end someday. But not here. Interestingly, not here. Once Dasharatha said what he said many years ago, there's no choice. He can't take it back. You cannot recall that spoken word. You know, an interesting thing. Of course, South Indian languages have a way of saying, oh, he's just talking, it's empty speech. Utti matalu, we can say in these languages, we can say. But I think the deeper notion is actually that there is no trivial speech. Actually, everything we say has consequences, is consequential. We're talking about consequential speech. I'll tell you another interesting thing. It's not only the spoken word itself. Scholars, Indologists like me, wasted many, many years, actually decades, in a kind of simple opposition between oral and written modes of speaking and writing in India. And people have said, correctly, I suppose, that there's a kind of preference for the oral, the power of the oral speech in India. But actually, the truth is, if I use the word truth, it's usually not just spoken words alone. It's spoken words accompanied by some bodily gesture of the hands, of the eyes, of the whole body. Actually, that's what writing, I think, means in traditional India. It means saying something and recording it, not on palm leaf, not on stone, but recording it in open space with gestures. And so I think that when Dasharatha said to Kaikeyi many years before, he said, okay, you have two boons. He must have also made certain gestures. It must have been there in his eyes or his hands or something like that. In any case, you can see that there's something here about language. So I'll say more about that in just a moment. Truth, I'll say it simply though, truth has something to do with what we say, with what a person says. What a person says is not a trivial thing and not a partial thing. It's something that comes out of the depths of the person. Now, there's another interesting thing in just these three little verses. You can see that there's a connection here with the with what is called vuyir in Tamil. Vuyir is the life breath. You can see, naturally, it comes in these verses. And in fact, throughout the whole passage, these people are concerned with the question of the breath of life, vuyir. Vuyir is a bit like prana in Sanskrit, but actually not quite the same. There are a number of important differences. For one thing, vuyir in classical Tamil, vuyir has certain attributes. For one thing, it's a unitary force. It's something which exists in a unitary way throughout the world. Everyone is breathing. The world itself is breathing. God is breathing. There's a kind of rhythm to this breathing. You breathe in and you breathe out. This vuyir, which is somehow the same, even though it goes in and out of all of us, comes in into our bodies and out of our bodies, but we also seem to breathe. That's what it looks like in Kamban. It's like we breathe in some kind of harmony with the way God himself breathes and with the way the world breathes. That changes in later Tamil. But in the time of Kamban, that seems to be the idea. Interesting, the truth and this living breath, the breath of life, are so closely connected in Tamil. And you can see easily from this passage that this is a kind of life and death matter, right? Truth, what we're calling truth, and especially somehow the truth of the spoken word, which is going to live itself out one way or another, that seems to be a question of life or death, or can become a question of life or death, right? So there's an intrinsic relation. You could say that truth and breath, that is to say, unmai and vuyir, they are somehow reflections of one another. They're intrinsically, deeply bound up with one another. You'll see it again in just a moment. Okay. Let's read another passage. Go on to the next passage, okay? All right, so here's, we're at a point that's a little farther along, not much farther along. The main thing that has happened now is that Kausalya, Rama's mother, Lakshma's mother, she's come to see what she can do. She's hurried to this place. She's heard that something has happened, and she's come to see what she can do in this situation. She's, of course, very distressed. Vasishtha is still there. Kaikeyi is still there. Dasharatha is there on the floor. So, I guess let's read a few words. This is a slightly longer passage. I'll read a few verses, and I'd like you also to try to listen to the feel of the text as I read. I prefer to read it to you in Tamil, but let's hope that something of it comes across in the English. Okay, and I'll read one Tamil verse at the end. Vasishtha just spent a few minutes speaking to Kaikeyi, once again trying to convince her that she should relent, that she should give up on this idea of what she's demanded. And of course, she can't give up for the reason that I've explained to you. So now let's read. The sage without blemish, that is Vasishtha, spoke. And the king, still very weak, looked at the woman with poison on her tongue and said, "Wicked one, did you tell my life's breath to depart for the fierce forest? And has he already set out? I know your heart, wicked as you are. For too many days have I swallowed the poison seeping from your luscious lips, and now you've eaten up my life at the root. When I took your hand long ago before the fire, it wasn't the queen that I married, but death in some new form whom I sought out. He is the eye by which I see. I have no other. He is the future of this family. In crooked ways you plotted to send him to the wilderness. You will kill me. You're shameless and low. Why keep saying it? That string that you wear on your neck as your wedding badge will be the string tied to the wrist of your son." I hope you understand the image. It means, of course, her Mangalsutra will be torn away. She'll be widowed, and that will become this Rakshabandhana that will be his coronation, Bharata's coronation sign. He went on like this, looking at the heartless woman, then to the sages, "I swear, she is no longer my wife. I've cast her off. As for Bharata, who is to be king, I no longer see him as my son. He's not fit to perform my last rites." To noble Kausalya, He who was blocked from seeing me before he left, did he also not see you? She had come to ease the grief she saw. For their son, like an eye to them, was set to depart, but seeing her failing now, the king too was failing. She knew. It was all the doing of the other wife. The king granted her wishes, but his heart couldn't take it. She wanted to comfort him by saying, he'll come back, but she hesitated at the thought that the king would break his word. Now comes the critical verse. She said to him, suffering as he suffered, great one, if you fail to hold fast to unerring truth, your greatness that no one can deny will turn to disgrace. If you are weakened by love that can't face separation from your son, the world won't approve. In agony, good Kausalya thought, our son won't not go. Again, the double negative. Our son won't not go, and the king can't not die. Tormented by what could happen to the king's good name, she couldn't ask him to hold back the prince. She groaned in pain. Listening to her words, the king understood. Our winsome son will not wed the earth. He will certainly leave for the wilderness. Grief overwhelmed him, and he cried, come help me, heavy with deeds. O my son, O my friend, why won't you come? So, first of all, you can see, even a short passage, you can see that Kamban has a kind of tremendous mastery over the psychological intricacies of the moment. It's always like that in Kamban. And there's quite a lot one could say about this passage, but we're only interested at the moment in truth. Okay, so let's look at this last verse. I'll sing it to you in Tamil, and then I'll try to say something about truth in a slightly wider sense than before. So you have the verse, those of you who know Tamil. Tala nilai sal mimai taruva vahai tanyevin illa nilai kur perumai kirivam yanalal ravoi villa nilai serambal mahanmel nilin ulahan kola dandro yendal kanavan kuraya kureval. It's a heart-rending verse in Tamil. Those of you who know Tamil, it's hard to read it without being overcome by the feeling. Look what she has to say about truth. She uses an interesting word. I translated this as unerring truth. If you fail to hold fast to unerring truth, she says to him. No, this is Kausalya. It's interesting. Kausalya, you would think she would do everything she possibly could to prevent this catastrophe that's about to happen. She doesn't want Rama to leave under any circumstances, but at this point she hesitates because she knows Dasharatha said something. If he doesn't hold to it, then some deeper catastrophe is likely to take place. This, by the way, is formulated very differently in the Valmiki Ramayana. If you look and see, you'll see that this question is not couched in these terms at all. Here there's this problem of what he said. And truth itself is characterized here. Tala nilai sal memmai. Memmai, it has the suffix of abstraction in Tamil. Truth, truthfulness, actually. But it's not a very abstract word, really. It's talking about something very, very concrete, something embedded in the word. Literally, it means tala nilai sal mimai. It's this truth that you cannot push aside. There's no way you can put it aside. It's unerring, you could say, but actually it means that you can't possibly avoid it. See, suppose he were to accept one of Vasishtha's recommendations, go back on his word. I mean, the cost of that, Kausalya knows that, the cost of that is unthinkable. You can't do that with a word that has been spoken. So, you know, I want to say a few things about this. I think really what we have to ask ourselves is why the spoken word is so powerful. Why it carries this charge. Why does it work like this? Why is it that if you say something, especially something that is pregnant with consequence, some kind of heightened utterance, but maybe anything that we say, why is it that you can't somehow work with it in some way that will reverse the consequences. Why? Why is it possible? So there are several possible answers to that. And we're not going to be able to exhaust the question here. And actually, there are more interesting parts of this question that I want to talk to you about. So I'm just going to say two or three things in a kind of, a mode of kind of showing you some directions we might begin to think about this question, why it is that this spoken word is so powerful. So the easy thing to say, of course, is that the spoken word, it speaks the self. It comes from some deep part of the self. It embodies what in Sanskrit is called vivaksha. Vivaksha is the urge to say, to speak the self, to speak oneself, to express oneself. You know, there's reason to believe that this is the strongest force in the universe, the urge to speak oneself. And it's not only human beings, by the way, who have this vivaksha. Everybody has it. Animals have it. Trees have it. Rocks have it. Everything in the world. In fact, the world itself has it. The world is constantly in this process of trying to speak itself, utter itself. Vivaksha. God has it. To say it in a kind of general way, you know. So it speaks the self, this spoken word. Once you've released it into the world, if you're going to somehow try to stop it or block it, then it's as if you were trying to destroy or harm some part of that speaking self. That's the easy way to think about that. It's not, unfortunately, enough. By the way, the prototypical kind of speech that is behind all of this is, I think, poetic speech. A poet speaks like that all the time. Poetic speech is the prototype. It's interesting that in South Indian languages, generally speaking, poetry is at the heart of speaking altogether. It's the truest form of speech. Grammar serves poetry in the South, unlike in Sanskrit, where grammar has its own logic, different logic. It's connected to poetry, but not doesn't serve poetry. In South Indian languages, all of them, grammar is somehow mortgaged to poetry. It's interesting because grammar is such a fundamental science. Okay, so there's the notion of speaking the self. Another way we could think about this, I'll just suggest it to you as a possible kind of direction, I'm not going to be able to explain it very fully, would be to think about the word as a kind of model. It models the world. And I'm using this word model, modeling, in a specific sense, following the work of a colleague of mine in Jerusalem, Don Handelman, whose name some of you will know perhaps, a very well-known anthropologist. You see, a model is not a picture of the thing it models. A model is a kind of condensation of certain forces, directions, vectors, energies that are condensed together in a way that is exactly similar to the way they operate in a wider field. By the way, I believe that this is somehow close to the way modern scientists, physicists use the word model, something like that. If you think of modeling like that, then the word is a kind of model of the universe, and it's also somehow harmonically resonant with the universe, so that if you change the composition of any element in the model, you will also change the composition of the entire field of force, the entire world in this case. Let me say it in a simpler way. Despite what we're trained to think in the sort of modern world, in traditional South India, words are not representational. They don't represent their object. They don't symbolize their object. If you ask anybody in a Western kind of, say, go to some Western university and you say, tell me about symbolism, then people will usually say, well, a word is a symbol. It's a symbol of the object that it represents. It represents the thing. If I say this podium, so, you know, that word is, as it were, a kind of symbolic representation of the podium. But actually in India, it's not like that. I don't know if you know that. Maybe you know it intuitively. In India, actually, the word is almost never representational. I'm exaggerating a little bit. There are contexts in which there is something like that. But generally speaking, the word is actually the potential object itself. There are many, many texts that I could cite to support this perhaps slightly exotic theory. It's funny that it would seem exotic to us today. But actually, it's the natural way of thinking about language, I believe, in all of the South Indian languages. You could take the view of someone like Bhartrihari, the great philosopher of language, Sanskrit philosopher of language from the 5th century. Bhartrihari, if you read Bhartrihari's Vakyapadiya, he will tell you that the world itself is made of sound, shabda. Reality is made of sound. So what is that sound? So to put it in a kind of sort of linear way, you would say that initially you could say there's a kind of sort of buzz in the world. The world is built up of this buzz. It's as if there was some tambura playing in the background all the time. This is a buzz that is just on the edge of being audible. We can't even usually hear it. It's some very subtle buzz that can emerge into audibility. If you let that buzz develop, after a while, it will congeal into a word. And if you let the process continue, that word object, I'd like to call it, that word will become the object itself. The word is the object in a kind of early potential state. You know, in Sanskrit, if you want to say object, the standard term is padartha, the meaning of a word. So we could actually talk about what I'm calling word objects or word facts, maybe, because the word is a fact. And if you begin to think about the world like that, as kind of throbbing and humming with all of these musical, rhythmic pulsations, you can begin to see why to speak in the world, to let the buzz congeal into audibility, you can begin to see why that might actually have a tremendous effect on the person, on his surroundings or her surroundings, on the world itself. And if we wanted to, we could also talk about what the Sanskrit grammarians called bhavana, which is something which happens in language when it moves in the direction of an incipient action, an action which is about to happen. Bhavana is a kind of imaginative act that happens every time we utter any sentence at all. And because of that imaginative act, what we say matters. It's a crucial thing, what we say. Never, or almost never, a trivial thing. Okay. So we've gotten into kind of deep waters, and we've gone away from this kind of terrible situation, and not by chance, because this terrible situation has no solution, as we all know. Rama is going to go to the forest. Dasharatha is going to die. We know that. And he's going to die because of truth, because he has to hold to his own truth, because he uttered this truth, and because if he tries to block that truth, then it'll be even worse than if he dies. So what have we seen? We've seen that there is a kind of relationship between the idea of truth or truthfulness and the spoken word, and in particular the spoken word accompanied by some kind of bodily gestures. And we've also seen that the word itself is a kind of object, like dreams, by the way. You know, words are a lot like dreams. Dreams, today we tend to think dreams are some kind of subjective reality, something that happens inside the inner space of ourselves, the personal space, but actually dreams in pre-modern India are objects like any other object, like words, in fact. There's one other thing I might say about the modeling of the word. One of the reasons that words are so useful as models is because they have a temporal aspect. They have time built into them. They have tense, that is to say, there's present, past, and future. But actually, tense and time are not the same thing in this domain. In any case, language has this temporality built into it. And that's why when Dasharatha said what he said to Kaikeyi many years before, it's as if the future was already there in some way, already existed in some sense. All it was waiting for was for him to utter that word that he has uttered. Okay, let's move on to another passage, because there's another element here. So far, you know, I've been talking about words and word facts and word objects, but I want to take this now to another level. Because what we've not really seen is what you could call the inner mechanism of this form of linguistic truth. So I want to show you something of what that might mean. Let's go to our third passage. So this is further along. This is a moment when, you know, Rama is getting ready to leave for the forest. And Lakshmana is very, very angry. He's so angry that he wants to kill Kaikeyi and Bharata. And Rama stops him from doing this. I want you to see how he stops him. Let's read this passage. Okay, so again, Lakshmana is in a kind of rage and fury, and Rama says to him the following thing. He says, "Brother, will your rage subside only after you go to war against our younger brother, who lives the good way that holds madness at bay, or after you've triumphed over our one father, whom great ones praise, or after conquering the woman who gave us birth?" He, Rama, knew what to say. He was good with words. Solum solvallan. He was good with words. His brother said, "I've borne words spoken by our enemies. Weary, I bear two tall rocks you can call my arms. I was born to bear this quiver and this bound bow. What use now is my fury?" Now Rama speaks in a beautiful verse. And Rama says, "To take the kingdom against the word of our father, who spoke only good words, who cared for me and raised me, be right. And what advantage is there for you in acting against my word?" Thus spoke the man who had gone to the end of southern speech and learned the northern wisdom to its limit. Yeah, I can see that. I'm glad that you're smiling, because this is a kind of pregnant verse, especially today. For the last 100 years, many people in the Tamil country have, they've been seduced by the idea that Tamil and Sanskrit are two kind of enemies, two opposites, that Sanskrit is some kind of foreign implant in the Tamil country, but nothing could be more wrong than that. You can see, we're reading Kamba Ramayanam. So what does he say about Rama? First of all, it turns out that Rama's mother tongue was Tamil, right? You can see by what he says here. He thinks of Rama as a Tamil speaker. And Ayodhya, you know, the Sarayu River and all of that, actually it's the Kaveri Delta. There's no question about anybody who reads the Kamba Ramayana knows that. You know, so Rama, this is the part that the Tamil nationalists might enjoy. Rama spoke Tamil. He was a native Tamil speaker. No question about that. He'd gone to the very limit. He'd gone to the end of southern speech. But he'd also learned the northern wisdom. He knew all of Sanskrit knowledge too. It's kind of nice to see this symbiosis, very natural in medieval Tamil. What is unnatural is this modern gobbledygook where these two languages are felt to be at war in some odd way. You know, it has no grounding whatsoever in pre-modern Tamil. It's kind of nice to see this, but I also want you to see another thing. Without elaborating very much on this passage, you can see Rama says to him, "Can't be right to take the kingdom by going against the word of our father." Notice that he's talking about words again. That's the natural tone of this entire passage. In fact, the whole Ayodhya Kanda is about that. And then he says, "And what advantage is there for you in acting against my word?" My word, yen sol kadandal. And the verb is kara, to go beyond, to transgress. If you go beyond what I have said. So here's a very interesting thing. This is something new that I haven't talked about yet, but very important. You see, it matters what we say. No question about that. It has a tremendous impact on the world, everything that we say. But it also has a personal quality. It's not an impersonal source. It has a personal and embodied quality. It's something that a living person says with his body, including his hand gestures and his eyes and the tone of his voice and all of those things. It's a personal thing. It's interesting because that's a little different from Sanskrit satya. I promised I'd come back to satya at some point. Satya seems to have a kind of abstract quality about it. truth in this Kambara Mayana world is a very personal thing. It's objectified in a sense. We're talking about word objects. This is an objectivist vision of language in the world. Words are objects. But that doesn't mean they're impersonal. On the contrary, they're highly personal. Everybody has his unique personal inflection, his particular way of speaking. I said earlier that the word comes out of the depths of the person. It's a kind of interior thing. Remember that the word unmai, truth, is somehow connected intuitively with that notion of a kind of inner experience, an innerness. It's an inner state of some kind. You know? It's a personal and embodied inner state. You might even say that the world of the Kaveri Delta in the 12th century, this world is actually composed of all these personal words that are kind of floating around in space, and that's what makes reality. That is what is real. So I want you to note the personal quality and the fact that this is not an abstraction. In fact, you know, if you read these verses, just these few verses from the Kambara Mayanam, suddenly, and if you begin to think about our modern Western European notions of truth, they look kind of oddly disembodied, suddenly, the Western European notions, don't they? Think about it. Truth. Truth is as if it were some abstract thing that existed out there. And you know, the problem of the human being was to find something that would represent it, actually. But this is a world where the truth does not exist out there. It exists in there. In there. It's an internal state, right? It's an internal state that is spoken, externalized in speech. Now, I want to go one further step, and we're getting close to the end, okay? You see, how shall I say this? Until now, we've been talking about the spoken word, about the word that comes out, enters into the world, and lives its own life as a kind of automatic, autonomous entity, right? But, you know, there are other kinds of statements, other modes of speaking. What are we going to do, for example, with words that are indirect in their statement? Words that are saturated with things that are not explicitly said. So this is the point where it would be very easy for me to say something which most of you may have heard in one form or another. It's very easy to say, people like to say things like, they're the words, and in between the words, they're the gaps between the words, so there's a kind of silence, and the truth resides in that silence between the words. You know, people like to say that. Actually, it's true. I'm sorry to say, actually, it's true. In a way, truth does reside in that kind of a sphere, but it's also a romantic way of talking. And I don't like this romantic way so much. And I think that there's a much more powerful way of saying it, much more powerful way. So let's look at another passage, and you'll see what I mean. Because when one begins to go more deeply into Tamil poetry, the thing that most impresses you, I think, is this is a kind of saturation of meaningfulness, and feeling, and complexity. And that saturation somehow infuses the words in a particular kind of way. So we'll go to the next passage. So this is already much later. Meanwhile, they've left Ayodhya, and they've been walking into the wilderness, and they come to Chitrakuta. Chitrakuta, at the end of the Chitrakuta Paralam, Lakshmana builds the hut, the Parnashala, in which Rama and Sita are going to live for some time. Lakshmana has built it himself. I should tell you, just last week, I saw an astonishing performance of this moment in Kudiyattam in Kerala, where Lakshmana built the hut. It took about 2 or 3 hours on stage, and bit by bit, branch by branch, leaf by leaf, he built this hut. It was an amazing tour de force. And actually, in the Kambara Mayanam too, the description of the building of the hut is very amazing. It's a very detailed description, including many words that come from the domain of house architecture, you could say, words that nobody knows anymore. They're there in the Kambara Mayanam. He describes in great detail. Anyway, when it's all finished, there's the moment where Lakshmana invites Rama and Sita into the hut. So that's the moment we're going to read. It's almost at the end of the Ayodhya Kam. Okay? When all was ready, that's right. When all was ready, He who is like the innerness of Brahma, who fills all space, and the inner surface of the living breath that we cannot conceive, entered his home with the goddess of gold. You could speak of that space as a mind free of delusion, or as the great Veda, or as the ocean of milk, or as heaven. Happy, he filled it with a friendly heart and a love none can imagine. Rama thought, the feet softer than flowers of this Mithila princess walked through the wilderness, and the hands of my flawless brother built this home. There's nothing those who have nothing can't do. It's a nice phrase. Then he looked at his brother. I want you to listen to what he says. He looked at his brother. True, he said, your arms are strong as two great mountains, but when did you learn how to do this? As he said it, his eyes filled with tears. It's a little unusual in Kambaramayana to have an actual sign like that. Usually Rama is kind of mysteriously impassive, a little beyond the situation. Here, this moment's a rich moment, his eyes filled with tears. And then he says a very remarkable thing. People will say of me that I followed my father's command when he gave away the rich kingdom, that I did what was right and was crowned with fame brighter than the sun. And so what? What's it worth when I've caused you such sorrow? You know, he's actually talking about the Kambaramayana. People will say, oh, I did the right thing. I followed my father's command. I went into the wilderness. I did everything right, everything right. But what's it worth, he said? What's it worth, actually, when I've caused you, Lakshmana, such sorrow? He spoke truth. See, here it is again. Again and again in the Ayodhya Kanda. This fascination with truth and what truth might mean. He spoke truth. What is the truth he spoke? The truth is, none of it makes any sense. It's completely worthless. The whole thing. Obeying his father's word. He spoke the truth. And his brother said, sick at heart, if you think about it, my dear brother, the seed of this grief was sown long ago. That's a very powerful statement that Lakshmana says. Just let your mind sort of dwell on it for a minute. What is he saying, Lakshmana, you know? Think of the complexity of Lakshmana's inner state. Think what he must be feeling. There are very complex relations that are taking place between these three people. Think of his own life, you know? So he doesn't say any of that. He says, the seed of this grief was sown long ago. And you can begin to imagine, I won't spell it out for you, but you can begin to imagine what he might mean by saying something like that. You know, it's a very strong statement. There's nothing to be done, thought Rama. We can't move away from what is right. Then he looked again at the suffering inside this person who had found such joy, Lakshmana, that is, and thought, we can't wipe away the knots of sorrow. So again, an interesting statement to come from Rama. Rama is God. In the Kambaramayanam, he's the God. And he says, we can't wipe away the knots of sorrow. The older brother looked at his brother and said, there's always an end to great riches. What can be lost by this? Think of the endless happiness ahead and what it will bring. It's again a kind of mysterious and complex statement. I'm not going to try to spell it out, and I don't want to spell it out because Kamban doesn't spell it out. He's said something, and he said something about what speech is like. See, in a way, the whole lecture that I've been giving for the last nearly an hour is only the prelude to a moment like this. We've talked about speech and speech acts and the truth that is embodied in speech. We've talked about the fact that truth here is not something that one knows. Interesting thing, if you think about it. It's not something that we know. Truth is something that we make or do or say. And we've talked about what exists inside a word that might make that possible. The spoken word, the spoken sound, the musical sound. But what we haven't talked about is that kind of speech which doesn't say explicitly and directly something that is it literally and exactly true, but only somehow suggests it or evokes it in some resonant way. Well, of course, it's not so surprising that that's the case. After all of the poetical traditions like to talk about these things, whether one calls it Dhwani or Vyanjana, or in Tamil, there's medieval Tamil, old Tamil is an important word, Iraichi. Actually, Tamil has a more interesting word. There's the Tolkapian speaks of what is called Ullurai Uvaman, that is upama, simile, resemblance, which speaks the inside. That's an interesting way of phrasing what is happening in the poetry. There's something, there's a kind of figurative twist or change which speaks something inside, some internal thing. Look at the first verse in this passage again, because he says, he's talking about the breath, I think, in which he says that it is the inner surface of the living breath. It's interesting that the wuyir, that living breath that is so important, has an inner surface, you know, must have an outer surface and an inner surface, apparently. Truth is apparently connected to the inner surface of the breath. You know? So there are all these words for suggestion, but here actually I think it's a more profound statement. There's a certain kind of speech which is somewhere on the border of what is said and what is not said, or is said in an indirect way, or in a suggested or resonant way. And that kind of speech has a grammar. One could write a grammar about that. One could also, actually I once had this ambition, I thought it would be possible to write a grammar of silence. Maybe I'll still do it someday, I don't know. A grammar of silence, because silence too has a grammar. It's fascinating that in this particular kind of world, you could write a grammar of silence. And if I had time, I'm afraid I don't have time, if I had time, I would read you from a passage in the Ayodhya Kandam in which silence is the real text, the real subject. Maybe I'll read you just 5 or 6 verses and then I'll conclude, okay? Is that all right? So, actually, the most beautiful part of the Ayodhya Kanda is the description of the way when Rama and Sita and Lakshmana leave the city goes silent. And you know that the people of Ayodhya follow them for some ways into the wilderness, right? So I'm just going to read you a few verses to give you some sense of that silence. Because this is another kind of speech. This is not the romantic view of silence as embodying some truth that is incapable of being articulated, what is called ineffable, ineffability. This is something very different from that. This is a different kind of truthfulness, and it's a silent truthfulness, the kind of statement. So I'll read you a few verses just so you can listen to it and feel the emotional quality and the complexity that Kamban gives us when he's describing this moment when they're leaving the city. This is in what is called the Nagar Ningir Paralam, the long chapter which describes leaving the city. Smoke vanished from kitchens. You don't have this, I'm sorry. You'll just have to listen to me read it. Smoke vanished from kitchens and incense of aloe from tall houses. Milk vanished from the vessels for feeding pet parrots. Babies vanished from their jeweled cradles or fell into a stupor. People's faces lost their glow as if life had left their bodies. Clouds lost their store of raindrops. Temples lost their pure rituals. And like bees that have lost their taste for the flower's nectar, elephants lost their heady joy. Parasols were bereft of shade. Women's hair was bereft of flowers. Warriors' legs were bereft of a hero's anklets. The arrows of desire were utterly bereft of fire. Andril birds, the crouncher birds, bereft, were torn from one another. Now the silence. I want you to listen to the silence. The bells tied to horses' necks fell silent. The great drums fell silent. Streets that were always roaring like thunder fell silent. Even rivers ceased to murmur with clear rushing waves. No drum sounded on the royal way. No veena sounded its strings. No festive cries to the gods could be heard. In fact, nothing was heard except gasps of grief. anklets were muted in golden houses, muted the rustle of jeweled belts. Birds were mute in the water. Forest groves were mute. Bees fell silent in the flowers, and elephants made no sound. Fields forgot the taste of water. The hands of red-lipped women forgot to hold newborn babies. Fires forgot the goodness of butter. Wise men forgot they had bodies, and the Vedas forgot they had sound. Those who once danced together were weeping. Those who sang the seven sweet notes were weeping. Women who once tore off garlands in rage at their lovers were now weeping. And women who made up after quarrels and made love also wept. And it goes on like that for another 50 verses. Okay, I'm going to try to sum up what I've said in just a minute or so. I don't know if I've convinced you that there's a South Indian notion of truth. There's a lot more to say about it, and we also haven't talked about the interesting question of freedom, of what freedom a person might have in a world where so much depends on what has been said and uttered. There is a dimension of freedom. Rama has a certain freedom. But what we can say is the following. What I would like to suggest to you is the following. That in this medieval Tamil world, truth is first and foremost something oral, that is something one hears, something musical, something rhythmic. It is largely non-cognitive or supra-epistemic. Those are heavy words. I'm a little embarrassed to use them. What it means is that truth is not about knowing something. Truth is a personal, individual matter, not easily generalized. It is linked to the inside, to the interior, maybe to the inner surface of the interior. It is linked to breath, wuya, and to the degrees of aliveness. It is something that is made, not revealed or discovered. It is often riddled with expressive silence and with jagged syntax. It is susceptible to dissonance, which is connected to freedom. It is existentially fragile, precarious. It is a human business. It is a human business, and as such, close to the God, and as such, capable of becoming real. Thank you very much.